So user interrupts, at least what we discussed yesterday was user interrupts is really a really fast way to signal. So today, today all the communication, like inter-process communication, I/O event delivery, they all happen through the kernel. The idea with user interrupts is deliver events directly to user space, so bypass the kernel and pretty much reach directly to the user. And this helps reduce latency. It's super fast and it's efficient. This feature is coming up in Sapphire Rapids on an x86 processor called Sapphire Rapids from Intel. Overall, there are multiple sources of user interrupts that can generate interrupts. One of them is a user-to-user IPC. It's called SendUIPI, which allows one application in user mode to send an API to another application running in user space to without any intervention from the kernel. So you just execute an instruction and you pretty much receive a notification on the other process. And there are other forms of user interrupts. Like one is where you could have a kernel source generate an interrupt that gets delivered to the user directly. The patches for this are still in development, but that is also possible with the Sapphire Rapids platform that I discussed. Now, in future, we envision to have other sources of interrupts like devices or any other external source that could generate an interrupt and it gets directly delivered to the application. This technology is still being defined and it would come up in the future, sometime in the future. So let me take a pause here and ask if there are any questions or if people have any interest in what comes next, or otherwise I can go ahead with the plan that I mentioned. Okay, I'm checking if there are questions on the chat. If not, then I can go ahead with how user interrupts are implemented on the hardware side. So for user interrupts, these are, I'll try to go through the hardware architecture and what are the basic architectural features which the OS needs to take care of, right? And so one is the there are a bunch of new x86 instructions. The one that I discussed earlier was SendUIPI. This is a user space instruction. It takes in a parameter. I'll go into the details of what this parameter is later, but it pretty much allows you to generate an interrupt on one process and generate a notification from one process and it gets delivered to the other one. UIRET, it's a user interrupt return handler. What this does is it allows, say if you have similar to signal handlers, if you have a user interrupt that gets generated, so let me actually share the sample that we went over yesterday. And so over here, this sample, what it does is you have a user interrupt handler. This is similar to a signal handler that would be called whenever you have a user interrupt delivered to the application. And so as part of this user interrupt handler, you have this interrupt attribute that is recognized by GCC 11. And so as part of this attribute, GCC saves all the registers that you need to save, like all the general purpose registers. And then when you're done processing the interrupt handler, you call UIRET, which is also automatically inserted by GCC. So applications don't need to worry about it. And when you call UIRET, the control would return back to where the application was interrupted. And so you can just continue executing where you were previously. So this is the SendUIPI instruction that I was talking about. This allows you to send the interrupt. Then there are a bunch of instructions called which help you manipulate the UIF flag. The UIF flag is called the user interrupt flag, and it lets you enable and disable interrupts or test whether interrupts are enabled or disabled. And so the instructions for it are similar to the x86 CLI STI instructions. It's STUI and CLUI and TestUI, which allow you to disable interrupts. So let's say if you're running some critical section, if this application wants to run some critical section and doesn't want to get interrupted, it would call CLUI. And once it's done processing the critical section, it would call STUI, and then it would go ahead, continue. That would enable interrupts, and it can get these interrupts delivered at a later point. So these are the x86 instructions. Any questions here? The next thing I'm planning to talk about is the, so actually there are a couple of, there's one question over here. Oh, actually there are a couple of questions. So one question from Jason is there any standardization work we can see for other sources? So for the source of interrupts right now, we're thinking it could be devices, but we haven't like narrowed down what exactly how it would look like. And so it would still take some time for us to put out something publicly. But on the receiver side, we think they would still look the same. So the receiver infrastructure is all common. And the way applications receive interrupts wouldn't change with what the source of interrupts is. And at the software side, what we were thinking is we would have an FT that the receiver would create as part of registering itself as a receiver. So when you create when you register yourself, you create an FT, and now you use this FT as an authentication mechanism for anyone to generate an interrupt for you. And so that would mean you can send this FT to another user space task. You could possibly send it to a kernel agent like IOU ring, or you could send it to a device driver, and then it can do the plumbing underneath to get connected to the. So actually the device driver itself wouldn't have to do the plumbing, but we would have some in-kernel API that would do the plumbing for the device driver. And so the device would just try to connect to that, and then eventually interrupts would be delivered to the application. Does that, I know it doesn't answer your question fully, but do you have any other questions, Jason? I would take it as a no. So one question from John is how the CPU knows the right processes and running in order to deliver them. Yeah, so that I would go over that. I would go through the step where from the exact point the send UIPI instruction gets executed to the point the interrupt gets delivered, and how what things get updated and how we get the interrupt delivered. So there is a question from Kim about, have you considered adding support to an existing IPC call and putting the user interrupt instructions in VDSO? So we haven't looked at VDSO, but we did look at considering an existing IPC system call. I forgot to say, so if you can download the slides, then you should be able to see this link where I've discussed where it is the first RFC patches that I've sent out probably last week. And so this is where you can see, like, I tried to compare it with signals and event FT and whether it's trying to see if we can fit this in. The main issue with fitting it with existing mechanisms was that these user interrupts depend on the hardware, and fitting like hardware, having a hardware abstraction and having a purely OS abstraction together was turning out to be a little bit complicated. So I have listed the reasons why we didn't do it, but overall it was just, it would be confusing for the user who's already used to some sort of guarantees from the existing IPC mechanism to use user interrupt FE in that direction. Another question from Claudia is, in case of x86, can a task interrupt any other task? So in case of denial of service. I do talk about denial of service in the RPC as well. The permission to interrupt a task is given by the receiver. So idea here is, if the receiver should share this only with trusted processes, like you can't use this, you can't share the user interrupt FT, or I wouldn't recommend sharing the user interrupt FT I wouldn't recommend sharing a user interrupt FT with a task that you wouldn't trust, because denial of service is definitely possible. Maybe one task might not be able to do it, but if you have like that same task that does multiple copy of this FD and all of them try to send interrupts at the same time, it would be possible to do a denial of service. And so this is only between processes, between tasks that are of the same address space, so within the same process, or across processes where you really trust the task. Okay, so the next one I have is this is how the hardware relates to the state of the task, right? So this is what connects with a user space task to how hardware sees it. So these are a bunch of MSRs, six namely. And they store the state. So this is what the hardware would refer when a particular task is running, about seeing where to store the task for that, to store the interrupts for that task, to have the handler address stored for the task. If the task has requested for a stack adjustment, then how much should the stack be adjusted? Do we need an alternate stack? And that's where we would put this. The kernel would put the information here. UPID. These are the pointers to the UPID and UIDD structs. I would discuss them in the next slide. But all of these are per thread task, and the kernel would save them as part of context switch. So each task would have its own set of values for these MSRs, and the kernel would save and restore them at every context switch the task goes through. And over here, the handler and all of that are specific to that same task. So right now, the way we've designed it in the first RFC is these are all unique to each task. So when you even if you have tasks of the same process, all of these values wouldn't carry forward to the other process to the other task. They would need to be like that task would have to register itself, register a handler for itself, and register different addresses to get this to get these populated. So now this is the main crux of the user interrupt delivery, right? And there are two main architectural structures that we have. Both of these are in-memory structures. They would be allocated by the kernel. One is called the UPID. This is the user posted interrupt descriptor. What this stores is, what pending interrupts are there, what is the existing notification state and the routing information. So before we go here, let me describe how this overall instruction works. So send UIPI overall is a posted instruction. So it's really an asynchronous instruction where a sender, it executes send UIPI and then it can go on continuing. So this instruction wouldn't block and you would continue doing something, whatever you want after this. Now the interrupt delivery could happen immediately if the receiving task is running on another CPU. If the task is not running, then the interrupt delivery would happen at a later time. And even if the task is running, it could have interrupts disabled using the CLI, a CLUI instruction that I mentioned. And so still the interrupt wouldn't be delivered at that time. And so this is truly a posted mechanism where you post the interrupt, and the receiver receives it at a different time. And so these are the structures that are used for that. And so when you actually execute send UIPI instruction, what the hardware does, what the instruction does, it updates a bit in this memory structure to say that, okay, this is the interrupt that I need to deliver. It's a memory structure. And so this would be able to be seen by the receiver as well when we context switch the receiver back. And so now it's saved this in memory, and now it tries, there is a bit called the SN bit and the ON bit. These two bits signify whether there is an ongoing notification for this task, or if the task is context switched out and we are suppressing notifications at this point. So after saving the interrupt vector, or after saving the interrupt in this bit, in this 64-bit memory space, the hardware would check the SN and the ON bit and see whether an actual interrupt needs to be generated for the receiver. Now, let's assume the case where the SN is zero. So we are not suppressing notification and we want to deliver an interrupt. So what we would do is, in that case, then generate. So what this UPID structure also holds is where this task is currently running. So it would hold the CPU, the physical destination. Right now this is x86 specific, so it would hold the x86 specific destination CPU in the UPID structure. And this structure would be updated every time the task context switches. So now you say, if you have a process running on CPU 0 and it moves to CPU 1, during context switch, the kernel would update that structure. And so this routing information is updated in the UPID structure. And so anytime a sender executes send UIPI, it would refer this, the hardware would do this automatically. Like, the application doesn't need to do it, but it would refer the routing information and it would send a physical IPI to the CPU that was actually running, that was running the task, that was the intended receiver. Now, how does the sender do this, right? This is the UPID is a receiver side structure, which is updated by the sender and referenced by the receiver. And now you have another structure called the UITT. The UITT is a sender side structure. And so the MSR that I talked about, the IA32 UITT MSR, it points to the user interrupt target table. And this table holds a bunch. So every time a sender registers itself as a sender, it would get a new entry added to this table. And each of these entries point to a specific receiver and a specific vector within that receiver. I apologize for this. Presentation tool misrouted this, but this is actually supposed to go from here. It is supposed to go through interrupt vector Y, and it's supposed to reach receiver task A UPID. And so what this does is, you have a send UIPI instruction. So now let's say the sender executed send UIPI 2. So if it executes send UIPI 2, the hardware would refer the UITT entry. The UITT entry would have the UPID pointer for the receiver task. So it would look at the SN, ON bit, the routing information, and then generate a physical interrupt that would eventually be routed and delivered to the CPU that was running task A. Now over here, the CPU, based on the MSRs that we have programmed, it would recognize that this is a user interrupt. And so instead of generating a kernel interrupt, it would deliver the interrupt to the user. And so it would load the handler address that we had programmed, and it would deliver the interrupt to the user. So that is pretty much how the send UIPI instruction works. I have another slide to talk about how the interrupt delivery happens on the receiver side, but this is how we the send UIPI from the sender side, this is how we send the interrupt to the receiver. And now on the receiver side, I can talk about how we deliver the interrupt on the receiver. But any questions here? I know I went over this pretty quickly since we just have a half an hour slot. Feel free to speak on the mic or post your questions over chat. I think someone, Lorenzo is typing. I'm waiting to see what he's typing. If not, then I would go to the next slide. So the question is, when is the IRQ delivered if the receiver task is not running? So if the receiver task is not running, then the IRQ would be delivered when the task gets scheduled back. Now, it depends on why the task was scheduled out. Say if the task got scheduled out just because it ran out of its time quota, because it ran for a long time and the scheduler just switched it out, then it would have to wait its turn. And when it gets scheduled back, the kernel would look at whether there are any pending interrupts in the UPID structure, and then it would deliver. So right now we do a self API, but there are other mechanisms to trigger a user interrupt as well. And so the kernel would pretty much update the structures, and when the task becomes running again, so when it moves to string 3, it would get the IRQ delivered. Now, let's say the task was blocked in the kernel. It did a blocking system call and it was blocked in the kernel. Then what we would do is the idea is the kernel would actually interrupt the blocking syscall. And so the blocking system call would get interrupted. The task would receive an e-inter similar to a signal handler. And we would deliver the user interrupt notification at that point. I do have an open over here where we're not sure whether we want to interrupt every blocking syscall or do we want to have a special syscall that just blocks for user interrupts. Right now in the RFC, I have a user interrupt wait system call that allows an application to block and wait for user interrupts. But like if you want to have a behavior similar to signals where like a sleep or a read or a epoll, you want to break out of a epoll, then we would have to do additional plumbing. But it is definitely possible architecture, hardware wise. Thanks, James. Yeah, that's all. So the question from Jason is the IRQ delivered to a single thread or any thread in a process? So the way it is designed right now, it would be delivered to the thread created the FT. Now, since this is hardware MSRs, it would be very tricky to figure out to figure out which threads are running and out of the process and be able to deliver it to a particular thread that is actually running, right? And so over here, the idea is it's mainly for a point-to-point communication between threads, where one thread generates a send UIP and it's targeted for a specific thread, and only that thread would be able to receive that interrupt. I've described, so if you look at the RFC, I've described how this compares with signal handlers and why we couldn't expand signal handlers. And one of the reasons is signal delivery is process directed, where any thread in a process could be running and it could receive the interrupt. But this is user interrupts in its current form is single threaded, where you have to have the thread running that is it's targeted for. Now, this is the second part where we talk about how user interrupt delivery works. So remember I talked about how the sender task executes send UIPI 2. So the first step we do is it update the UPID. So at the sender side, we update the UPID. The second step that happens is generate the notification vector interrupt. And this would happen depending on whether the receiver is running or not. And that is updated by the kernel into the UPID struct. And so if the receiver is running, we generate a notification interrupt. When this notification interrupt gets delivered on the receiving CPU, we recognize the interrupt as a user interrupt, move the pending interrupt from the memory structure to the hardware MSR. So this is where we actually detect the interrupt, right? Because up till now, the interrupt was only posted in a memory descriptor, and now we move it to a interrupt move it actually to the MSR. And this is where we detect the interrupt. And now the delivery of the interrupt happens if the application has enabled interrupts, right? So if it has executed XTUI, then we would push the vector onto the stack, the vector that was generated as registered as part of the FT creation. We push it onto the stack. This helps the application recognize which sender is it receiving this event from. So we have 64 vectors, and this is the vector that it is receiving. Based on this vector, it can determine which is the sender that sent it. And then it invokes the handler. And so this is how the handler invocation works, right? Where you have the UIRR, and you move it to from the URRR, you call the handler. The handler address is stored in the I32 handler MSR. So the hardware switches to the handler MSR, to the address pointed by the handler MSR, and then you have the vector that is delivered to the hardware, and then by the hardware to the application, and then it does a UI ret, and you return from the syscall. So that's all that I had. I know the time is up. Is there someone else following this, or can we hang on over here for a few minutes if people want to continue here?
Yeah, technically there's nobody following. The keynote is in 30 minutes, so you can have another 10 to 15 minutes if you really want.
Okay. I don't know. I don't have much to present. I just wanted to give time for questions. If people have questions, then we might continue. Otherwise, we can call it a session.
So if people do have questions, we'll get through them faster if they actually ask over audio.
Yeah, I was hoping that too, but it's like a shy audience. They prefer to ask it through a chat. Yeah, I don't have anything after this. This is all that I wanted to discuss about how the interrupts get delivered. I had to go through this quickly, so please feel free to ask questions if you have. Or you can go through, if you want to read up, then you can read up the patches that I have. And in that, I have links for the GitHub repo where these patches are stored, and we have additional samples and tests that run on this. There is also a link to the hardware specification, and you can always reach out to me at the email address. The email address is also there in the slide, and it is also there in the patch series. So I see Lorenzo typing in, so I'll just wait if he wants a question. Okay. He'll probably reach out offline. So I don't think we have much. Thanks, James, for letting me continue for a few minutes. That's all that I have.